Amen. Come on, let's give Jesus all the praise. He's worthy. He's the Lord. God bless you guys. You may be seated. I'm just very, very proud and honored to be a part of this tonight. I'm excited about this year. You know, back in July, Pastor Jonathan asked me to take each first Wednesday this year, and immediately the Lord dropped in my heart that I should teach you the Sermon on the Mount. And I thought, well, you know, everybody's heard the Sermon on the Mount. He said, no, I want you to disciple the church in the Sermon on the Mount. And so I've been reading it, you know, for several months, going through it, reading books. And a lot of what I say to you tonight and in this series is going to come out of books. I can't refer to them every time, but, you know, do your own study. You'll figure out how great it is. But I want to just read, first of all, the actual verses, and then we're going to pray. And I'm in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 1. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into the mountain. And when he had sat down, this is Jesus, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth, and he taught them, saying, blessed or happy are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. You notice it starts with the kingdom of heaven, his message. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. He continues, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are they that have been persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when men shall reproach you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets that were before you. And blessed are the Clemson Tigers because they defeated the Alabama Crimson Tide. Come on, somebody. No, that's not in there. I'm still smiling from ear to ear. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap for that wonderful. Praise his holy name. Lift your hands, let's pray. Father, we just thank you tonight. We're going to study your word. And Lord Jesus, you preach this sermon, not me. I'm just reminding people of what you said. Everything's in red in this message. So Lord, let our ears be open and our eyes be attentive. Let us, Lord, spend every Wednesday night, the first Wednesday of this year, studying this glorious sermon, the greatest of all sermons ever written. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Open our eyes and our ears. In your name we pray. And everybody said, amen and amen. Come on, give Jesus another hand clap. He's wonderful. Okay. So guys, what if you want to just sort of track with me, I'm going to teach you now. I'm not going to do, you know, preaching. We got the real John Gray tomorrow night to do the preaching. Come on now, that's going to be good. And Friday night's going to be amazing too. Don't miss a night. Pastor Tim from Lafayette is one of the best preachers I've ever heard in America. So you don't want to miss tomorrow night and Friday night. But tonight I'm just going to start this teaching. And Jonathan asked me to sort of take the first night and key off what I'm going to do the rest of the year. So the word heaven is the key to the book, to the Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, to the Sermon on the Mount. That word heaven is mentioned 22 times in these three chapters, which is one out of every four verses. Every fourth verse you have the word heaven. So in my understanding, and I've read this Sermon on the Mount many times now, what I see is that Jesus is trying to talk to his disciples. It said he brought his disciples up on the mountain and he taught them about heaven. And we're going to cover finances and heavenly finances. We're going to cover heavenly marriage. We're going to cover heavenly attitudes, heavenly relationships. We get everything about this is going to be about how to live like a heavenly citizen. You know, Paul told us in Colossians, he said, set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. And my goodness, we got so many newspapers telling us the things that are on the earth. I mean, everywhere we go. But on these first Wednesdays, I'm going to talk to you about heaven, how to live as a heavenly citizen. how to live as a heavenly ambassador. And it's going to be, Jesus is going to preach it for us, but you're going to apply it in that. And if we just took the word heaven and earth, just start right there. I mean, that's not in your outline, but I just wanted you to get that graphic to begin with, because what the Lord is saying is that there's a difference. Once you follow me, he's saying, you're going to begin to think like heaven instead of earth. And that's the problem, the renewing of your mind. Discipleship is about the renewing of your mind. And the renewing of your mind is when your mind begins to think the way heaven thinks. So in this sermon, he said things like, you know, you have heard it said, that's on the earth, that you shall not kill. That's the earth. That's true. That's a law. But he said, but I say to you, you shall not hate your brother in your heart, or you shall not call him a fool, or you shall not. He said, you have heard that it said, you shall not commit adultery. And you know, that's also something we understand on earth. But he said, but I say to you in heaven, he said, we don't even think about wanting to commit adultery. It's the want to, the desire. And then he said, you've heard on earth, it's an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. You know, that you, what somebody does to you, you're free to do that back to them. But he said, I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those that despitefully use you. So I could go on and on. I'm not gonna get ahead of myself. That's gonna be the fourth month that we do that. We're gonna talk about those attitudes and emotions and all. But notice it throughout it. He's saying on earth, men are worried about piling up treasure. But he said, I say to you, don't worry about that, because your Father knows you already need these things, and he feeds the birds, and he's gonna take care of you too. Come on now. So it's all about heavenly thinking. Remember that. Every fourth verse in these three chapters is the word heaven. Our Father who art in heaven. So I'm going to talk really the whole year about heaven, how to think, how you act, how it changes your marriage, changes your business, your thoughts, everything about it. Now tonight, I'm starting with heavenly attitudes. Uh-oh. The Beatitudes, which is the two words we've combined for beautiful attitudes or blessed attitudes. The Beatitudes, that's that word, is not in the original Beatitudes, but it's something we used in English to describe these eight qualities. Now, I don't know what's going on in your life. I have no idea. I don't know what relationship problems you're in. I don't know if you're saved. I don't know if you used to be saved, your front slid, back slid. I don't know what's going on in you. But I'm going to tell you the first four are going to have to do with how your mind brings you into the presence of God. These are attitudes toward God. Yes. And the last four are going to be how you then take what you learn from God in heaven and apply that to your relationships on the earth. So it's very, very important that you get the fact that the first four are about God and the second four are about man. Now, you understand that an ambassador does not represent himself. He goes to a country. Let's say, you know, in the country he's from, they all wear turbans. I've been all over the world, and I've seen these guys, the Sikhs and different ones. They wear turbans. And the moment a Sikh gets on an airplane, whoever, you know, that he's from India. I mean, that's it. You know, they ain't wearing turbans over in Zachary very much. Come on now. You know what I'm talking about. So if I'm an ambassador from India, and I come walking in, I got a turban on. Everybody says, yeah, that guy's from India. Yeah, that's a Sikh. I know where he's from. You know, back there, they got the little red dot on, and they this and that. And that, you know, that's it. That's a Sikh. Well, see, he's carrying his nation with him, even though he's here. Now, that's what an ambassador does. He does not represent himself, but he models and represents the place he's coming from. He don't have any opinions. He's got a culture that he represents. Here's the thing you have to understand as a Christian. When you get saved, when you come to know the Lord, you become a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. And not just a citizen. We're going to read the eight attitudes of a kingdom citizen. But not only that, you are going to become an ambassador of the kingdom of heaven. You're going to look like heaven. You're going to walk like heaven. Come on. I don't know what that is, but it's good. Maybe it's 4 inches off the ground. I don't know what it is, but you're from heaven. You're not earthly anymore. Come on now. You're not. It says, reckon yourselves dead. You're alive with Christ. You're seated with Christ. So you're a heavenly person now, and you're representing the kingdom of God as an ambassador. Now, the first thing he said, blessed are the poor in spirit. You notice he doesn't say poor in finances. The moment people read that first word, they think, oh, I've got too much money. It does not say anything about that. In fact, we know that wealthy people followed the Lord Jesus and ministered to him of their means. Some ladies, very, very wealthy, they supported the kingdom of God. We know that Abraham was rich in cattle and gold and livestock and all of this stuff. Job was the richest man, wealthiest man of all the East. So the Lord doesn't care that you have money. He don't want money to have you. Come on now, right? So it's not about poverty. Get that first one out of your mind. These first four are really about how you and I relate to God. This is how we relate to God. And the first way you relate to God is you have to be a spiritual zero. That you and I cannot save ourselves. We are not self-righteous. We contribute nothing toward our salvation. Now, the opposite of that is our world. You know, that's heaven, but the world is very self-righteous right now. On earth today, you can buy tens of thousands of self-help books, humanistic books that tell you that if you'll improve your socioeconomic position, you can do it yourself, that you are becoming the savior of the world. In Genesis 3, the devil came to Eve and said, if you'll eat that tree, well, you'll be like God. See, the devil's always tried to make man think, you don't need God, you are God. You're going to be like God. That's what humanism is. And so then I think about the Tower of Babel, how they said, hey, we're going to go out there and we're going to make us some bricks and we're going to stack them up and we're going to reach the heavens. And we're going to just get up there and touch heaven. We're going to see what's going on. It's like the Russians when they went in space, they didn't believe there was a real God. And one guy, you know, was on a tether. He was out there and he was looking into space, a Russian cosmonaut. And there's a famous little phrase that they have in Russia. It says, Boga нет. The first cosmonaut, when he walked, did his spacewalk, he did like this, and he looked, and he said, Boga нет, no God. In other words, I've been to space, and I've looked out there, and there's no God. Somebody said if he would have unplugged his tether, he would have seen God. But you know, self-righteousness, we don't need the blood, we don't need the cross, but the Tower of Babel, they said, we're going to do that. Dude, they might have been as well been stacking greasy BBs. You can't save yourself. We have nothing in my hands I bring, the hymn said. Saving to the cross I cling. So in Revelation 3:17, here's a verse. He says, for you say I'm rich and I have prospered and I need nothing, not realizing that you're wretched and pitiable and poor and blind and naked. Spiritually, we're all totally bankrupt. We don't have one penny in our pocket when it comes to getting right with God. Can you say amen to that? We're the prodigal son. We're in the hog pen. We're out of money. We're feeding pigs. We have nothing. Zero, nothing, nothing. And you say, well, I've done a bunch for God. Well, zero plus zero is
zero.
And you can have 10,000 zeros, dude, and you're still a big
zero.
So I think we have to start there. When Jesus opened his mouth, he said, blessed are the poor in spirit. Now, I don't know, you may be a wealthy businessman here tonight. You may be a professor in college. You may be a political leader. Very, very successful, and everybody knows, and you're strutting your good works around like the NBC peacock. You know what I'm talking about? Your intelligence, your skill, and your personality and all that. But Paul called his self-righteousness rubbish. And he used a different word. He used dung. He said, I count all those things. I'm a Pharisee of the Pharisee. I've studied at the feet of Gamaliel. I've done all these things. He says, but I count it all as devil swamp. It's rubbish. It's nothing. It's Coke bottles, cans, bottle tops, and vanilla wafer wrappers. That's all it is. That's where you start. Just see law about that just a minute. And then the second thing he said, and blessed are those that mourn. Now, I don't know that we're going to get through all eight of these tonight. I'm going to do my best. But how many of you would give me a break? If I don't get through all of them, you'll let me move it on to the next month. Okay, right? But I ain't worried about that. I want you to get it. How do I approach God? You start as a big
zero.
A goose egg, baby. Nothing. And then second word, blessed are those who mourn. Now you have realized your position and you come to the Lord with a broken heart. I believe in brokenness for true salvation. We get people somewhere, time in a room, and we say, here, sign this card right here. Hey, dude, you're fine now. You're all good. And there's no repentance. There's no godly sorrow over what they've done to God, what they did putting him on the cross, what they've done in their past. There's none of that. No mourning. But when I look, this is because the world is very self-focused. The world is not really that bothered when a plane goes down. I know they think about it for a day or two, but, it's like, okay, or the marketplaces, a guy drives a truck through it, or, we're in our world today, we're very self-focused. It's like, well, what am I going to eat for lunch today? And Jesus had this entirely different thing. He said, when you're a kingdom representative, when you are representing heaven, first of all, you're nothing. You know you're nothing. It's only Jesus Christ and him crucified that you are in. But the second thing he says is you're going to have to get the heart of the Father for the needs of the world in this world. You're going to have to ask God. It says Jesus wept, the shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus wept. What was he doing? He was at the tomb of Lazarus. He saw Mary and Martha, his friends, had lost their brother, and he was not there. And the Bible says he wept. He entered into the feeling of their infirmities. The world doesn't feel anymore. Timothy says that in the last days, perilous times will come, and people will become unfeeling. They will not feel that someone had 5 feet of water in their house and they don't know where to live. They won't feel. They'll go right on to the next news story. Come on, are you listening to me? Blessed, happy are those who enter into the care and the concern like Jesus when he wept over Jerusalem. Because they were missing the moment of their visitation. So you begin to pick up on the fact that in heaven, first of all, nobody's proud of their spiritual accomplishments. Or nobody came to heaven because they were a Republican or a Democrat. Come on now. They only there because of Jesus. He gets all the glory. He gets all the credit. He gets all the praise. There's only one name we want to glorify. And what is that name?
Jesus.
That's right. And then once you get that, then you say, Lord, give me your heart. Give me your heart. You say, why is Surge planting all these churches? Because we have the heart for the world. We have a heart for the 69 tribes in Brazil that are not unreached. They're uncontacted. No human has ever been there outside of their tribe. We see them running in the bush below from a helicopter with no clothing on. They've never had anyone from the outside world there. Yes, the tree people that are 80 feet up in trees in Indonesia, and we've planted 11 churches there. They've come down out of the trees. They put on clothes. Come on, are you listening to me? They've gotten right with God. They live on an island in Indonesia. Yes, the boat people in Indonesia who live on boats, they never touch solid land. If they touch land, they get land sick. No, not really. I'm telling you, I have a heart. How many of you would say, God, give me a heart for the needs of the world? Yeah. Romans 12 and verse 10 says, weep with those who weep. Something should be moved within us when we see the world is being destroyed by the enemy. I'm telling you, I could just go on and on and on about blessed are those that mourn. But then we come to a third step in knowing God, in approaching him correctly, and that's blessed are the meek. And you immediately think blessed are the weak, don't you? You thought I said weak. I didn't say weak. You think of meekness as somebody with a real severe underbite like Gomer Pyle, and they're really like meek, like, hi, man, oh, yo, my God, man. But you don't understand that meekness is a Greek word that means to control and tame a stallion. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm a stallion. You ladies had a hard time saying that, didn't you? I'm a stallion. What does that mean? Meekness is about the controlling of the will. And the world is about self-will. Self-will. There's magazines called Self. Self-will. I'm going to do what I want. I am going to do this. And I have the will power to do that. Can I tell you something? Your willpower ain't going to work in all situations. You need a culture from heaven that transforms you and sets you free from drugs, because you can't say tomorrow I'm going to quit drugs. You need the power of the Holy Ghost setting you free from drugs. Amen? And you know, a stallion is a powerful beast. They weigh 1,500 pounds. That horse, man, he's powerful. I got on one time. And that horse started taking off, and I was trying to pull that horse to the left, and that horse went straight for a barbed wire fence and threw me about 10 feet in the air, and I landed in a barbed wire fence, and then she just stopped and looked at me, and if she was laughing, I think she could have. They are the will in a horse is unbelievable. And that's why the psalmist said, don't be like the horse that has to be turned with a bit and a bridle. Now, meekness means to tame the power of that wild stallion. You've got talents, abilities, gifts. You have all these things that you come into the kingdom of God with, and you think, well, you know what? I qualify to be something in the kingdom of God. No, you don't. I've known many people that were overqualified to work in the kingdom of God. They walk in the door, they're businessmen. Well, I can take care of the finances here. I know how this is all supposed to work. No, you don't. Now, you don't know anything. Actually, you come in the kingdom of God, the Lord hands you a bit, and you just slip it in your mouth. And he climbs on your back, and he spurs you a little bit and says, giddy up. That's right. And you know, a wild stallion is a wonderful thing when he's tame, because he can win a race. A wild stallion has tremendous power. Now, I'm talking, that's you. I'm speaking to you about the things of the kingdom of heaven. In heaven, talents don't mean anything. It's the submission of those talents to the king that matters. Now, I don't know. Are you well educated? Surrender that thing to the lordship of Jesus Christ. Are you a gifted speaker? Surrender that. Are you a gifted singer? Almost all the Golden Globes and all that is nothing but old-time people that used to be in churches singing. And they've now surrendered it to the devil and all that. Well, not me. I've surrendered every gift I have. I don't have a gift that's not under the lordship of Christ. I'm that little donkey that Jesus rode into Jerusalem on. I've got him on my back, and I'm not waving to the adoring masses as I go into Jerusalem. I'm pointing to him. He's on me. He's got me. How many of you say he's in control of my life? That's right. And see what this means? What this really means is that stubbornness. Stubbornness doesn't work in the kingdom of God. I'll do what I want. Like that little boy I've told you about 100 times in the movie, he kept standing up on his chair, and his dad said, you sit down. He wouldn't. He'd finally sit down, and then he'd stand up again. And his dad said, if you stand up one more time, I'm going to whip you. And the little boy folded his arms. He said, I'm sitting down on the outside, but I'm standing up on the inside. How many of you have ever dealt with a child throwing a temper tantrum? Any of you ever? I've seen them at 18 months get on the floor and hold their breath. And mom and daddy go crazy. I don't. I just figure, hey, you'll breathe eventually. I'll talk to you later. There will be a moment where they'll suck a lot of air in. That will. Listen, I've got 6 kids. They're all in the ministry here in this church, but I had to whip all of them so many times I can't even count. Including your pastor, many, 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 many times. But the Bible says, remember not the former things, neither call them to mind. But I'll tell you what, that will is really, really strong. And if you look at Moses in the Bible, he was educated. Pharaoh's daughter adopted him. He was the next in line to be Pharaoh. Next in line. And the Bible says he despised the riches of Egypt. And he surrendered himself to the Lord. And he said, Lord, whatever you want me to do. And he led 3 million people out of bondage and slavery. And then his sister and his brother rose up against him and said that he'd married an Ethiopian woman. And he didn't even answer them. He never defended himself. He never retaliated. He never asserted himself. And the Bible says that the man Moses was the most meek man on the face of the whole earth. Meekness. I want that. I don't mind being strong. I want to be strong. I want to be a stallion for the Lord. But I want him on my back with a bit in my mouth. And he just got to go like that. And I go that direction. How many of you want the Lord to lead you in righteousness? Use you for his glory. See, we're climbing the first half of the stairs. Jesus is telling us what it takes to be a heavenly ambassador to represent the way heaven thinks. Only one guy rose up in pride against God. Only one. And he lasted a few seconds in heaven. And that was Satan. Don't rise up against God. Bad idea. And number four, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. I like that. I laugh all the time thinking about my friend who was on a 21-day fast here in Baton Rouge. And he asked a guy in our church, a lawyer, if he could go out to his farm and just be out there where there was no food or anything for 21 days. He was seeking the Lord. And he got out there and he said, sure, you can go there if you'll just feed my horses every day. He said, oh, okay, I'll do that, no problem. On about the 14th day of that fast, he brought a bucket of oats out there to that horse. Come on now, don't get ahead of me. And that horse's head came over the fence and it went down in that bucket and started going. And he said he couldn't resist. He just got him a handful and went down with it. Now that's what you call starving. When you start eating the horse's oats, you're starving. And this is the word the Lord used. Blessed are those that are starving for righteousness, for they shall be filled. You know, this is a word that talks about love. You know, when you're really in love with someone, and I'm in love with that lady over there on the front row. 40 years this year we've been married. That's right. But I'm not just married to her. Now, I'm sure if I didn't love her, I would stay married, you know, just out of, you know, well, I made a covenant and all that. That's good. That's where you are. But I'm not there. I'm in love with her. Now, see, I came down here this morning. I taught the business lunch today. I spent the whole afternoon down here. And I got here in the green room, and my baby wasn't here. And she got caught in traffic, and then she came walking in. I said, there's my baby right there. My boo and my bae. Come on now. So if I had a hard time just this afternoon being away from her, what do you think it was like when I was in Asia in October for 19 days? In Singapore, Manila, Philippines, and Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. 19 days, 11 flights. And I called her on the phone, and I texted her, and I FaceTimed her and all that. But, brother, I was missing my boo. Come on, all you men, shake your right hand if you feel the anointing on that right there. I feel sorry for these men that marry men. I really do. I feel very sorry for them. Now, I'm not saying that out of spite or anything, but I don't know what they see in another man. I really don't. But you need an appetite for the Lord Jesus. And I'm going to tell you what your problem is. You say, well, I hadn't prayed in a few days, but I'm going to probably do that tomorrow. Well, let me tell you what your problem is. You are snacking on the world. Y'all know what snacking is? I travel. They put these gift baskets in the room in the hotel. I finally had to tell them, no, don't put any more of those in there. I will eat everything they put in that basket. It doesn't matter if the basket's this big. By the time I leave, it's all gone. So I finally just said, don't put any bad, put water in there or some fruit or something. Because I don't know what it is, but I love to snack. How many of you love to snack? Come on, Christmas time. Now help me out. chocolate-covered pecans. Come on now. And the problem is you're nibbling a little bit over here on this sport, this hobby, and this entertainment over here, and this thing over here. And, you know, the average American now is checking their cell phone 150 times a day. The average. And they say that that's not counting touches. That's just how many times you pull it out of your pocket and get started. Clicks, you know how many clicks you're doing on an average? 2,200 a day. That's right. Touches and clicks. Notifications. Some of you got so many watches and phones and everything. You're in a meeting, your hip goes, and your arm goes, it's no wonder you're not hungry for God. You're snacking on everything. Pokemon. 6-7 hours till 2 o'clock in the morning. You're snacking on just whatever you can find your hand to, every chocolate, everything. But the Lord said, this is Jesus talking to you. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Now we've reached the top of the first four. I cannot do the next four. I'm out of time. Until next month. Come on now. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the peacemakers, not the troublemakers. Blessed are those that are persecuted. I'll get to that next month. How many of you want to climb those stairs this year and really reach the throne of God so you can represent Him in this world? If that's you, stand up on your feet. Stand up on your feet. I feel the presence of God here. I wouldn't plan on stopping there. You got an outline with all the rest of it in it, but I'll just pick right up here. Save that in your Bible because we're going to stake on right there. I want you to lift up your hands right where you are, and I want you to become a zero before God. Not a one, not a half, not 10, not a million. You're not a million. You and I are a zero. Peter said, "Depart from me, Lord, I'm a sinful man." And I look at my life and I know it's the mercy of God that I'm saved. I'm not a good person. Without Jesus Christ, I was wicked. I had a wicked tongue and mouth. So many things, but the Lord saved me at 16. He rescued me, delivered me from so many unclean and wrong things that I had drifted into as a teenager. But today I stand before Him as a zero and His one is in front of me. And He's saying, "I'm the one, you're the zero, and I can make you 10 times greater than you ever thought." Come on, let's just lift up our hands and praise Him and be blessed because we're poor in spirit. Thank you, my Lord. I should hear some people really out of their mouth saying, "Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I honor you. I worship you. Oh, I thank you. I thank you, Lord God. You lifted me out of a horrible pit, a deep and a slimy pit. And you set my feet on a rock and put a new song in my mouth. You put clothes on me spiritually. You washed me, cleansed me, sanctified me, wrote my name in the book of life. You brought me to heavenly places and sat me down with you, Lord. I'm poor in spirit, but I love you." You could just wave your hands just over that first one. You could just thank Him. Yeah, you may be worth millions of dollars, but it doesn't have you. You won't take any of it anyway to heaven. They don't need it up there. But all you'll do is use it down here for the kingdom of heaven. But I say tonight to you, be blessed. Be blessed because you are poor in spirit. And that's just the start of the kingdom of God. Tonight is the appetizer of heaven. I thank you for it, Lord. I praise you. Now just put your hands down. I can't ever... never close the service without giving you an opportunity. If you're here, sir, ma'am, young person, you're thinking, "Wow, I don't think I've ever heard anything quite like that. Heaven over earth. I never heard that." This is what Jesus is teaching us. I don't care if you're a Catholic, Presbyterian, and Baptist all at the same time. If you're not following Jesus, sir, ma'am, young person, if you have not made a trip to heaven and received His life and now you're His representative, you know you're not ready for heaven. You'll see that. He said, many will come to me in that day and say, Lord, Lord, have I not done this and have I not done that? He'll say, depart from me, I never knew you. He's going to say that in the 7th chapter of the sermon. If you're here and you would say, you know what, Pastor, examining my heart about poor in spirit and about mourning over sin and over the condition of the world and over meekness, giving all my gifts and talents and strengths to the Lord and over my hungry appetite really being for Jesus and prayer like Moses in the wilderness in the mountain 80 days and Paul in the wilderness. I don't have that. I need that. And I want this year to be different. I want to surrender my life to the Lord Jesus. Now keep your heads bowed. Put your hands down if you're here and you would be honest. Get honest. And say, I'm not sure that I'm right with God. If I died tonight in my sleep, I'm not sure where I would go, heaven or hell. But tonight, I want to surrender everything to the King of God, the King of glory. Everything in my life, I want to surrender to the Lord. Now, I'm going to look around this room as your heads are bowed. And if you would say, that's me, I want to be included in that prayer. This is your moment. Without hesitation, what I want you to do right now is slip up that hand, hold it up high, and say, I surrender. I surrender. That's right. All over this building. There, there, there. I surrender to the Lord. That's right. There, back there, up here in the front, over there on the side. A number of people, you're raising up your hand. You may put your hand down. Now, second question for you. How many of you would say to me, you know, Pastor, I am a Christian already, but I can tell in these last 7 days where we've had prayer and all that going on here, I can tell that I've been way too caught up in the world. And this year, I want to be a heavenly citizen, and I want to be an ambassador of heaven everywhere I go. I want my life to be different this year, and I want you to pray for me that it would be. I want you to raise up your hand. If you're looking at your life right now and saying, I don't like it. I'm thinking like the world. I'm thinking of a self-focus, self-will, self-righteous, all of those things, self-satisfying. And tonight, I want to come back to the Lord. First love, first base, home plate, zero. I want the Lord. I'm punching the odometer. I want all zeros. I'm coming back to the Lord. If that's you, lift up both of your hands right where you're standing. Father, we're thankful that we can come back to zero. We can come right back, Lord, to the very first moment where we felt the first wave of forgiveness hit us and our sins were washed away. Forgive us, Lord, for loving the things of the world more than we have loved the presence of God. And I thank you for Pastor Jonathan leading us in prayer. Thank you for the Wednesday morning prayer meetings all this year. Thank you, Lord, for First Wednesday where people are going to be discipled and grow and elevated this year. Let them not miss a time. May they be blessed, Lord. Their household be blessed that they will read the one-year Bible this year as Pastor Jonathan is leading us through it. They will not miss a day, and they will not miss a day of fellowship with you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. This is a year of commitment and separation from the world. We're heavenly beings and we're heavenly ambassadors, and I speak a blessing over your people tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. I tell you, I feel his presence in here right now. I feel his presence. Let's begin to give the Lord some praise in here. Come on, let's begin to give the Lord a great shout of praise. Hallelujah.